Bang, here I come. Hello, sports fans, sports collectors, and all hobbyists. Welcome to the Card King Sports and Variety Show. I am your host, the Catman, Brian Cataquet, a.k.a. the Card King. We are live on ABC's KMET 1490AM.com, your number one spot right here for news and talk on the West Coast. I thank everyone for tuning in this morning. On the telephone line, I welcome to the program the son of the legendary Mickey Mantle. We welcome in David Mantle, who joins us. David, what an honor for me. Thanks for being here.
Sir, it's my honor, and I appreciate you asking me.
Oh, you know, this is unbelievable for me to have a Mantle associated, you know, on my show. It's really, truly an honor. Thanks so much.
Well, I tell you what, it's kind of a sad note. I'm glad you got me or Danny. You know, it's just us now that keep Dad's memory out there and tell the stories that we remember.
Absolutely. So David, I want to begin. Your senior year in high school, 1974, you attended an old-timers game, Rangers Stadium, I believe. Your dad, Mickey Mantle, was introduced, and the roar of the crowd made you realize for the first time just how big of a deal Mickey Mantle was, right? Talk about that day.
Oh, yes. God, on that day, I can't believe it. I was 18, you know, of course, it's summertime, so I'd graduated from high school. And, you know, me and my date, you know, of course, we're standing up, too, with all the fans. And, you know, you've seen it and how fans, you know, when they adore one of their players, man, you know, they show it. And what was strange and just so great and fantastic about this, you know, it was an old-timers game. But it was in Texas, not New York. And the crowd, I mean, it just went absolutely wild. I mean, just the noise with cheers, the clapping. Everybody stood up. Nobody sat down. And I thought to myself, it took that moment right then. You know, here I was, 18, graduated. Not until then did I really find out what Dad meant to his fans. I mean, that right there showed me there was more than just love and stuff. It was, you know, admiration, everything.
And, David, there were other Yankee greats that day, like Casey Stengel, and I believe Dimaggio was there, but no one got the ovation like the Mick, right?
No, and, you know, nothing against Joe D, but he would get jealous, you know, because – you know, just couldn't have it. Maybe it's because Dad, you know, a lot of times back then, Dad hadn't been retired too long. And Joe D, you know, retired like, I think, what, 52 or something like that. So Dad was still fresh in their memories. And, you know, besides everybody just loving him, Dad would always get a little bit of a extra, say, applause or standing ovation. And, you know, Joe was the kind that, you know, would get a little upset. So I think that might have been one of the games. I know that after that and maybe one other one where Dad and Joe D were introduced separately, you know, Dad seemed to – another time Dad got a longer standing ovation and cheers and all that stuff. So it had to become, say, like if it was – I guess just in Joe D's contract or whatever, if they do one for something like that, or it was just known that if Mick's there, they are introduced together.
And you know, David, I have a question on Joe D, but before that, you know, another big day was your dad's retirement day, right? He didn't get choked up. Mantle didn't get choked up a lot, but there he did on his retirement day, right?
Oh, yeah. I think it was when he was doing his little speech saying thank you after they'd done the ceremony and all that stuff. It was Dad's turn to, you know, talk to the fans. And he used Lou Gehrig's speech right, as an example. You know, he was saying that, you know, how could a man come out here and stand and, you know, talk to fans knowing he was going to die? And Dad said that took so much courage.
And, you know, we all know what a larger than life figure Mickey Mantle was. David, growing up, let's say your teen years, during the off season when your dad was around, was it difficult going out for a meal with the family alone?
It depended. To tell you the truth, I know at least with me and my brother sometimes, and I bet Mom really prayed for it, that when we went out, you know, it wouldn't be too bad. But, you know, it's going to happen. But, you know, we just didn't want Dad to, you know, be in a mood or whatever and, you know, not sign something or whatever. And, you know, that's one reason why Dad had those special little cards. They're like, what, about 3x5s or whatever it was or something, you know, had a picture of him and then stats on the back. He would sign that and pass those out to people because, you know, when you think about it, at first, you know, being in a restaurant or something like that, he'd end up signing, you know, like a cocktail napkin. And, you know, that, you know, when you think, Dad was a perfectionist, and he wanted, you know, that's one reason why you could read his signature. You know, he didn't just scribble. Of course, a lot of the old guys back then didn't scribble. You could see their names. But he wanted it to be clear. And, you know, like on a napkin, if it's with a Sharpie, it would run, you know, kind of soak into it. And he just wanted a clean, clear, exact signature of his name. But
and, you know,
it was just funny. You know, it's just, we just hoped that, you know, Dad would be in a good mood. And I remember one time a gentleman came over and we were getting ready to leave and so was he. And we were up in front getting ready to walk out and a gentleman came over and asked for an autograph and Dad was just kind of go, man, you know, not now or something like that. And then the guy kind of started walking. Of course, Dad waited till he got halfway down the block, and he gave me one of those cards. He goes, man, go give this to that guy. So I had to run after him. he goes, I mean, Dad, he'd get mad at himself for not doing it. You know, he'd
really?
Say no and then go, man, no. He goes, come here. You know, he'd do that. But at dinner tables, he'd always go, too, get back to that real quick. He goes, man, I've been watching you. He goes, it's not doing the autograph. He goes, but why do you wait till I get my meal?
Oh,
that's
wow.
What he just didn't. Once the meal got there, he wanted privacy so, you know, he could eat, you know, a hot meal.
Right, right. Are you since we're on the topic of the autograph, are you surprised how much his rookie card sold for? Millions and millions of dollars.
Oh, you know, I had a chance on my second wife. We went down and we were living in Tampa, St. Pete area. And, you know, that's when, right when the baseball card shows were starting to take off and all that junk, I think it was like 89, excuse me, that we were there. And I got to know this guy, and, you know, he was a really nice guy, and, you know, we got along good. He had one of Dad's rookie cards, and back then they weren't graded. So I have no idea what it was, but I looked at it, and I can remember it looked pretty good with me, you know, just looking at the borders and, you know, no wrinkles, no, you know, blah, blah, blah on it or something. And he says, man, you know, because we're friends and, you know, he's your dad, man, I'll let you have this for $5,000.
Wow.
And I just go, oh, my God. I looked at my wife, Marla, and I go, God. But, you know, we were just starting out, and I was down there working for a company. And I didn't have any money saved up. In fact, you know, it's just, you know, with car payments, this and that, it just wasn't feasible. So I'm thinking to myself, and I'm talking to Marla, and I'm just going, God, should I call Dad and please, Dad, loan me $5,000. We can get a rookie card in the family. We can have one now, finally. And because we've never owned one. We've never had one. If we did, it went in our bike spokes. Because I remember the last one of those I did. I go, here, Yogi, let's go riding. And I put Yogi in my front spoke, and we took off. But, God, that was our chance to have a rookie. And I just keep thinking back about now. You know, the way I remember, you know, I'm not real good at memory, but looking at it, you know, and when they started grading, I always say, I told my little, I guarantee you it was at least a 7.
Wow. I mean, as you know, that rookie card
coming from the Mantle family.
Yeah, as you know, his rookie card sold for like $12.6 million.
Yeah. It's just, one thing, I bet Dad, you know, he never understood this. He was very damn proud that, you know, his fans would stand in those lines. Because, you know, he only did 800 signatures at the shows he would do. You know, usually he did both days. But they would stand in line, and he just goes, I feel bad charging these guys what the promoter's charging. Because Dad got his fee, and then I guess the promoter wanted to get some too. But, you know, God, when Dad's signature, I think it got up to 100 back then, but I do remember 80. And he's just going, you know, he really felt bad. And I'll kind of quit talking about that. But there was another thing, because we would take turns traveling with Dad to help him with the card shows. You know, we would kind of stand by him and, you know, just kind of watch people. Or one of us would sit down, and as he did an autograph, we scratched off a number. We had a copy of 1 through 800, so we would just scratch them off. You know, just no offense to some of the promoters, but you know, we just want to make sure they didn't sneak in another amount. But it was just oh Lord, it was fun.
We're talking with David Mantle, the son of the legendary Mickey Mantle. David, as you got older, talking with your dad, a few things that I wanted to ask you. First, did he ever say or mention anything about Joe DiMaggio as far as having resentment toward him, you know, taking over the center field position as Joe D was heading out?
You know, Dad never really talked about anybody, but with us, you know, being his family, say if we were, you know, going somewhere and maybe Joe D was going to be there, he would just kind of talk about that, you know. Joe was a quiet man, and he was different. I mean, look at, he got to marry Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah.
And, but Joe D, I never really thought, so I don't know how Joe D was with his fans, like signing autographs and stuff. But Dad said he was kind of quiet though. But Dad said what he missed about it, when Dad came in as a rookie, he really kind of thought that Joe D, and that's more or less what they were training Dad to take over Joe D for when he retired, that, you know, he might have given him some tips or you know, have breakfast, have lunch, just, you know, BS about the game and stuff. And Joe was just secluded, and or I don't know, it, you know, this is just what other people have said, because Dad never talked bad about any other teammates, you know, Joe D, but the rest of them, there's never any animosity. But you know, I think in a way, Dad wished that Joe D had been a little more upfront, whatever you call it. You know, like sitting next to him and talking to him, or you know, on the bench in the dugout, you know, during the game, you know, get little tips here and there. Hey, you know, about maybe a pitcher he was going to see, but Joe D was not that type. And I hate to say it, but I feel that, you know, Joe D was retiring and his career was over, but I think he was, I don't know, what is it, you know, already seeing how, what kind of fans and how they adored him and how they showed it and stuff, that hurt Joe's ego, I think. So that's one reason, like I said, he wanted to be introduced with Dad. So that way he couldn't tell if it was just for Dad, but it was for both of them.
Now, I remember reading a book a while ago, a few years ago. It was called Dinner with DiMaggio, and there was mention in that book something like DiMaggio could never get over his grudge against Mickey Mantle.
Maybe, you know what? I could see that, and I guess there really was a grudge. And, you know, Dad was always polite, never said, at least I never heard him say anything bad about Joe D. He would just say that, you know, we weren't close. Because when Dad, a new rookie, would come in, and Dad, shoot, man, the first day, that night, you know, he would take the rookies out to dinner, and, man, they'd sit and hang around and, you know, get to know. He made everybody feel welcomed. And Joe D didn't do that. And I, you know, I guess Joe had that personality where I hate to say it, but you know, he was jealous of that, I guess, of the attention he got.
Yeah, I agree with you. And how about like some of the other great ball players that played during the era, you know, with your dad, like Willie Mays, Hank Aaron, Roberto Clemente? Did your dad ever mention any of those greats to you?
Oh, I don't know if any of the fans listening today, though, but maybe they can Google it or look it up or whatever. But there was an old show that came on. It was called Home Run Derby.
Yes.
And that's where, you know, they'd have two batters. And sometimes, I guess it was like a National League against the American League. But Dad and Willie, and I think he did one with Hank Aaron, too, they would all, like, have, you know, the home run battle against each other. And it kind of went back and forth. One day, Willie would win. You know, next time or something, Dad would win. But they sit there and did it. I wish people could Google this, too. Look up the Willie Mays, Mickey Mantle, Blue Bonnet butter commercial. They Dad said it took like all day for them to record the commercial. And usually Dad and Willie, they were pretty good. I mean, Dad was just a natural. I mean, sometimes if he was doing something, then they kept the first take of it. But they were sitting there, and, of course, they had the corn on the cob in front of them. And, you know, the butter there, the blue bonnet. And then they had, like, bonnets on Dad and Willie. And they kept, every time they looked at each other, they just burst out laughing. Oh, it's hard for them. They just look at it. He goes, man, look at us. We're wearing bonnets.
And you know, David, one of the many traits that's remarkable about Mickey Mantle was his switch hitting ability, the power from both sides. I mean, you know, he had those big Popeye arms. Is that a God-given ability? I mean, how was he able to generate so much power from the left and right side? What was his workout regimen?
Well, you know, they didn't really do weights back then, but what Dad, I guess, was blessed with this job. It was hard as heck and dangerous in a way, but he worked with his father down in the lead zinc mines there by Commerce, Oklahoma. And his job was the sledgehammer guy and to bust rocks. So just think of swinging that sledgehammer all day long, breaking rocks. That's going to build your back up, those forearms, your wrists. That, you know, at least with me, man, when I hit a baseball, I use a lot of my wrists, too, to get that snap out there. But, you know, he had that going for him. So that's why he was already kind of built, but he never really did waste it with things like that. And then, of course, then a lot of folks probably don't know. It's not like now. The off seasons, Dad would go back to the mines. Hank Bauer had another job. Moose had whatever. John Blanchard did this at a car dealership. I can't remember what Elson would do, but, God, I mean, everybody, they had a sideshow to go home to and start doing again. But that's why back then, winning the World Series wasn't just to say you did it. It was because you got that bonus.
Unbelievable. So now, when you were a kid, your first impression of New York City?
Oh, I just loved it. And I don't know if I've already told you, but, you know, because of baseball, I grew up singing the national anthem. That's how I look at it. And I finally figured out, God, you know, just being a kid and 18 years of Dad playing and spring training games, you know, when we were there, you stand for the national anthem. And I did that. And I think that's why even in the schools when you could still do it back in those days, too, that, you know, I felt so honored and blessed that I could, you know, sing the national anthem. And it just got to where, like in New York, there you've got the Statue of Liberty that, you know, you can go see that. And that, you know, revokes, you know, or not revokes, but, you know, just made me think of, you know, some of the immigrants that have come in and end up fighting in the army and dying for seeing just the Statue of Liberty.
Man, and what was your impression of, you know, the early Yankee Stadium?
Oh, I loved it. Me and Mickey, I wish Mickey was still alive, because, God, he was pretty good about remembering everything, and you could talk to him. But it was after Dad passed away, and it was at the old Yankee Stadium. And it was like right after Mr. Steinbrenner did that first remodel. I think that was, what, around 75 or something, I think, maybe.
Right, 70s.
Me and Mick were there, Junior, for something, and I forgot who was we were walking with. Might have just been somebody with the Yankee front office. But we're walking through these halls and stuff. Back in those days, it was fun. If the players brought the kids to the stadium too for the game or whatever, us kids, we just ran around terrorizing everybody and hung out. Of course, we get in trouble after the game. Our dads would let us know, but Mickey'd go, "David, do you remember these halls?" And I'm just looking at, you know, they weren't real wide either, and you know, you see like the whatever different type of pipes that are up on the walls and the ceiling. He goes, "Man, all this was, you know, just so neat." Mickey, he was just reminiscing about just what kind of, I guess, pride or whatever he felt walking through the underneath the Yankee Stadium, you know, to finally get to the locker room. But he loved, and just remembering just walking through the stadium and underneath it, and you know, a lot of history there. No, it's like he's no telling who's walked in front of us.
And, you know, David, I watched the movie 61. That was a movie in which you appeared in. I remember in that movie, I guess Mantle and Maris, they shared a room together in the beginning. Was that in Jersey?
Yeah, this is the funniest year. You know, Dad, and they lived with Bob Serb also. And they all three lived. And, man, Roger and Dad never had an argument. And they weren't against each other, but they loved that stuff, because Dad, either one of them, whoever got the paper first, and the other one would eat a bowl of cereal or something before they went to, "Look, Mick, we're fighting again." And Dad would come in and went, "Oh, look what we've done now, Rog. We hate each other and this and that." And I would tell people, I said, "Did they not know you all were living together?" I mean, but for someone living together and getting along and hanging out and stuff, they were in a fight every day.
But they really got along together, right?
Oh, yes. I mean, and this is sad, too. It's like in 1985, I believe, when Roger passed away. I did a lot of restaurant business, and the restaurant I was in the bar area. And, you know, of course, at that time in the 80s, that's when bars were putting TVs in the in them, so you know people could watch games and stuff. And it was before we even opened, and it came out they were interviewing like Whitey and a bunch of other Yankees, because they are happened to be at the first Yankee fantasy camp that was done. And you know, they had Dad and all of them there, so they were kind of taking their turn you know, interviewing them and everything. And it, Whitey just finished or something, and then Dad walked in to start saying, you know, his words about Roger. Dad got so upset he had to walk off. He couldn't talk, so he started crying.
So now you also had some act. You know, I have a few minutes left. You've also had an acting career. Talk about some of your movies.
I don't know. I kind of started late. But I wish I would have done it earlier. But, yeah, I just I happened to meet a few people here in Dallas that, you know, handled extras and all that kind of stuff in movies. And, you know, they could get me little small parts. But both the ones I did, they ended up cutting out of the movie. But it was still fun just being there and, you know, hanging out with, you know, people. I never, you know, like Dad said, never bug, you know, a star or celebrity. But then, you know, they were like, you know, and if they're on the series or whatever, which I kind of did stuff on, stand-ins and blah, blah, blah. But if you go to that IMDb, you'll get to see some of my stuff. But I didn't really do too much, but I would, just kind of do little extra stuff, and I just had fun being out there, and, you know, it kind of gave me something to do, and I kind of started thinking, you know, people want to interview me. Let me take a chance at this. I had headshots made and this and that, and, of course, I got to know Debbie real good, who did casting and all that kind of stuff, and God, she was talking about me. I was in better shape then. She was talking about, you know, I think Gladiator had come out, or maybe it was, whatever kind of movie it was. She was talking about there was going to be some kind of movie like that. And, you know, just with my physique, I wasn't real muscular and stuff, but I was kind of big just for my size and everything. She goes, man, you can play in that and be one of these guys. But the biggest thing I ever did was, I got to play like a governor of some state, and I had like two words, and I can't even remember the words now. And it's funny, I got there like in the morning. The scene I was in was finally shot like at 12 midnight. I'm going, and stuff like that, I kind of go, you know what, this really ain't worth it unless you're making a few million.
Yeah, and I have about 30 seconds left, David. So what, oh, what man, have
I'm
you
sorry.
Been up to?
We're already done?
This is great. What have you been up to?
I tell you what's really been going on, thanks to folks like you and the Tulsa Drillers and God, who else? Oh, and I do a lot of things for veterans now too. So we, I've got a couple of friends in that. Garrett George is one of the main ones that got me into it. But you know, we'll do like those softball games for veterans. We take them out, you know, and take them out for a weekend or whatever, 3 or 4 days, down to like some property in Texas, down by San Antonio, Texas. Man, let them ride horses, let them do whatever they want, just relax and try to get their minds off, you know, what horror is, you know, messing with them. And of course, if they have had some injuries and, you know, if they're in wheelchairs and stuff, you know, we do, you know, everybody just got together and you could tell these guys, you know, that they had something in common, and that was a bond you'll never break.
Man, so hey, listen, we were just, I'm sorry. This was truly an honor. This is truly an honor having a Mantle on this program. Thank you so much, David.
Hey, please do me a favor. When you get bored or something again, call me again, and we'll do it again.
Yeah, we got to do a part two.
We got a lot more to talk about.
You got it, my man. Thanks so much.
Hey, God bless you all, man. Thank you so much, sir.
You too. My pleasure. The son of Mick, David Mantle. Until next week, happy collecting to all.